Thank you to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk and for giving me an excuse to visit Paris. So I'm going to talk about joint work with Peter Varju, and in fact, it's not only joint work with Varju, but it's also based on previous work that Varju did by himself. And let me begin by just recalling some very basic things about random walks on the plane. On the line, simplest possible scenario. So I have some random variable, xi, so it could be maybe finitely many possibilities for xi, maybe it's a continuous distribution. I prefer to think of the case of the, so even though it's not essential for the theorems, in my mind, I'm thinking always of the case that my random variables are finitely supported. And then, sort of very classical question, if I take independent random variables, sum them together, how are they distributed? So the law of large numbers says I can normalize things so that the expected value is zero. And then the law of the large numbers says that if I look at the scale of n, I don't see anything interesting, right? The sum would converge almost surely to zero. I can look with a better microscope, I can scale up to size square root of n. And then I'm beginning to see things which are a bit more interesting. There's the central limit theorem. As long as I have a finite second moment, the sum would behave like a Gaussian. It's also well known. They use this notation n sigma squared mu to be the Gaussian with mean mu and variance sigma squared. Now, you could go on and on to finer scales. So you could maybe look what happens at the scale 1. That might be another interesting thing. And then you already see that there's a new phenomenon. If you look at scale 1, well, perhaps your random walk is a random walk on the integers. Perhaps you're doing the simple random walk going probability half 1 unit distance to the right with probability half 1 unit distance to the left. And then, of course, if you look at the scale of 1, you see this lattice behavior. So here you need to put a condition. If you really want to be able to go to scale 1, you need to put a condition that my random variable is not of lattice type. So it's not contained in a affine image of the integers. Once you make this assumption, then you have the local limit theorem, which tells you, so if you fix the NB, remember that my Gaussian, the sum should behave like a Gaussian of standard deviation square root of n. So if I fix A and B, I'm basically looking very close, right? So I have sort of this huge Gaussian. It's a nice board. So I'm basically looking at a place where the Gaussian is essentially constant. So the local limit theorem tells me that the probability of my sum being between two values is proportional to the length of the interval, with the proportionality being exactly the value of the density of the Gaussian at zero. You could think of it as an equidistribution result. So if I have two functions, f and g, maybe compactly supported, and just to make sure that the denominator is not zero, let's take the denominator to be the function, the denominator to be non-negative, and of course not identically zero. Then if I sample f at the sum of n random variables, and I sum g at the sum of n random variables, well, these would have the expected value of these would tend to the integral of f over integral of g. It's just saying that you have that Sn conditioned that it lies, that it's small, is somehow uniformly distributed. You could actually find something which, so this tells you, so the local limit theorem tells you at a scale of one what happens for the Gaussian at the center. You could actually have a statement which combines both the central limit theorem and the local limit theorem. And this is the local central limit theorem. And I think one statement, but you need to make even more assumptions here. So in addition to assuming that my random walk is non-Gaussian, non-lattice, sorry, my random walk is non-lattice, I'm also assuming that it has a finite third moment, for instance. And then what you see, you have some kind of estimate that the probability of my random walk being between two values is the same as the probability that a Gaussian of the right variance and mean would be in the same range, times some error. It's probably plus epsilon. I meant to say that it's basically n to the minus. The error is basically of size n to the minus 1/2. Yeah, that's sort of supposed to be plus. And then there's some error, which is little of n to the minus 1/2. If you remember, if I look at my interval at scale 1, then the Gaussian has probability of square root 1 over square root n to be in this interval of size 1. So as long as I take look at intervals of size bigger than 1, at least sort of moderately near the center, this term is negligible. And okay, so I get approximate Gaussian distribution. So it's related to the Berry Essene bounds. I'm not, it's not something I'm an expert on, but anyway, it's well known for some people. Now you could ask, you might want to go even to finer scales. And on this, I'm not so sure what exists in the literature, but certainly you can't go to very fine scales. So if, for instance, all of your, you have a random variable of lattice type and you add some, another option which is, so you go, maybe you have some random walk which goes alpha. So x is maybe alpha minus alpha, beta minus beta, each one with probability 1/4, and alpha and beta are linearly independent over Q. Okay? You have something like that. Then this is a random walk of non-lattice type. Everything would be fine, but the number of possible values, Sn would have at most, Sn has something like n squared possible values. So if I have n squared possible values, obviously if I'm going to look at intervals which are of size less than 1 over n squared, then I'm going to see things which are completely meaningless. Now, okay, everything I said, random walk on the line, is true for random walks on the plane, random walks in RD. This, for these things, nothing changes. But I can do another kind of random walk on the Euclidean plane. So instead of adding a random vector, I'm applying a random isometry of the plane. So an isometry of the plane, I can rotate and shift. And then it's sort of similar, but instead of adding, I compose these isometries. So it's basically going to be So if you work out what this means, I start with some point. So I apply this Sn, which is now the composition of all these operators, to some point P. Then basically I take P and add to it something, then add to it something rotated, etc. So basically it's some kind of sum, but it's a more complicated. It depends the sum. It's a sum of n terms, but the n terms depend on all of these rotations. It's a twisted random walk in some sense. But it's still a random walk on the Euclidean space. And OK, one thing which is reasonable to assume, or at least which makes the issue non-trivial, maybe all of these are just rotations. Then, of course, I start with a vector. I end up with a vector of the same length. Or maybe there's a common fixed point. So it's not rotations around the origin, but it's rotation around some other point. OK, then the distance to this other point is fixed. Nothing very interesting happens. So I'm going to assume that there's no common fixed point. Now I'm going to assume, now you can look at the rotation part. If the rotation part is trivial, then we're back to the old random walk. If the rotation part is non-trivial, then this becomes more, this becomes different. And I'm actually going to make an assumption, which is not quite necessary, but I'm going to make the assumption that the rotation part is as big as it can be. That is to say, if I just look at the rotations of my collection of isometries of the plane, just the rotation part, then if I look at the group generated by it, it's going to be a dense subgroup of SOD. So this is an assumption which sort of makes me in some sense, exploit the features of the isometry group to the fullest. And under this assumption, so I said that there's no common fixed point, but there's a point whose average remains the same, which would, of course, be a natural center of things. So I'm just going to normalize it to be zero so that everything would be centered at zero. Now, I have, if I just look at the rotation part, I can look from the, right, so I have some kind of a random variable, which is a random isometry. The rotation part is a random element of SOD. I can look at the associated averaging operator. Let's call it T of F. Right, so this is an operator which has an eigenfunction of eigenvalue 1, namely, the constant function. I think of it as an operator on the square integrable functions on SOD. So it has one eigenfunction of eigenvalue 1, the constant eigenfunction. And a remarkable fact, if you think about it, it's highly non-intuitive, that on for d bigger than or equal to 3, on 3 and higher dimensions, you could have a collection of rotations which have a spectral gap. So the best situation, maybe if your set of rotations is symmetric, what this means is that any function in L2, which is of mean 0, I apply this t to it, its L2 norm is going to be reduced. Now that's a very strong statement because I'm not saying anything about how wildly the function varies. It could oscillate extremely rapidly. And it could oscillate in a way which is designed by somebody who knows my rotations in a malicious way. And still, whatever happens, the averaging reduces the L2 norm. It's a very strong statement. But OK, we'll see later. It's a very strong statement, but surprisingly, it's actually quite prevalent. So this is, this is a theorem on random walks. I was referring to the title. You could think of it as this is maybe the main theorem, though it would follow. Okay, we will talk about that later. But this is a theorem on random walks. So I'm assuming, like I had even in two, line, I'm assuming that my that this random walk has finite moments for some alpha bigger than two. And I'm assuming that I have some random walk by isometries. I'm assuming that the averaging operator corresponding to the rotation parts has a spectral gap. Okay, these are the assumptions. I'm assuming, of course, that these rotations have no common fixed point. Then I can look for some point x naught. Maybe the notations are not the best, but I put some little arrow to make it a bit less painful. So this is a vector in Rd. I apply to it n random isometries. Okay, so I get some new point in Rd. And I look at the expected value of this. So not too surprising. It's some kind, like I told you, if I apply n isometries, I'm basically adding, it basically translates to a sum of n things. So it's not so surprising that it would converge, the distribution would converge in scale square root of n to a Gaussian. So central limit theorem holds. Because I'm assuming that I have, that my rotation parts are dense, it's not so surprising that this Gaussian is not just any Gaussian, but it's a rotationally symmetric Gaussian. So Zn is going to be a rotationally symmetric Gaussian of variance, I don't know if it's written here, variance n times some positive sigma squared. So roughly, I have a central limit theorem. But so the important thing here is not the central limit theorem, which was known before due to don't want to mispronounce the name, or mispronounce I would, but I want to mispronounce it in a minimally. Tutubalin. Central limit theorem is due to Tutubalin. But important thing here are the error terms. So there are some error terms which depend on the L1 norm of F. Polynomial in L1 norm of F. And there's another error term which depends on how discontinuous F is, how wild it behaves, some kind of Sobolev norm. In particular, it's sort of d plus 1 over 2 L2 derivatives is the thing which controls here this term. Anyway, some kind of bound on F on its derivatives with an exponential term. And the exponential here is important. So what does this mean? So this is, I can put here any test function I want. What test function would I maybe want to take? Maybe I would like a test function which is a bump function on some very small set. So this is a small set. I have here a test function, positive, right? So what this would tell me essentially is the probability that this random walk would be in a ball of radius. I'm taking this bump function to be maybe of size exponentially small in n. So my test function is some kind of bump function located in an exponentially small area. And then here everything is related to the L1 norm of F. So basically, L1 norm of F, maybe if I'm not so far away from the center, is roughly um, would be roughly of order of this term. So this is smaller than the main term. And what sort of becomes bad if I take a function which is very, very concentrated in an exponentially small range? So again, if I apply the same logic as before, I have n isometries. I multiply, suppose I have maybe my random variable x, suppose it has 10 possible values. I apply n of them, I get at most 10 to the n possible isometries, right? So if I look at scales finer than 10 to the minus n, obviously I'm not going to see anything interesting. The part which sort of tells you how fine a scale you can look at is the part which depends on the derivative of f, which has this very good exponential error bound. So sort of the moral of this is if I do a random walk on the plane with isometries with the spectral gap assumption, the rotation part, then I get a central limit theorem which is incredibly stronger than what I got without the rotation part. It's true up to an exponentially small scale. So there are efficient ways to generate a Gaussian distribution, but if you wanted to, you could use this as a fairly good way to generate a Gaussian distribution. Okay, so this is our result. It has some history. There are previous results. I mentioned some of it already, but I'll mention it again. And there's going to be prehistory and then history. So the prehistory, I refer to results of the 60s and 70s. And there were basically two. So one result in the generality I'm talking about, which was actually later extended to greater generality, but is the central limit theorem. Just telling you that you have a central limit theorem here, and this is due to Balin, which, okay, gives you a precise description of the distribution of my random walk at scale square root of n. And the local limit theorem is due to Kashdan and Gvarsh. So two papers. It tells you what the local limit theorem tells. So it tells you that at scale one, next to the center of the Gaussian, the distribution is uniform. Or if you want, it's slightly weaker because here there's the right scaling. If you sample two compactly supported continuous functions at the random walk at stage n, then the ratio of the expected values would converge to the ratio of the integrals.
This is for every x naught or for almost
every x naught? It's every x naught. You fix x naught and you allow n to go to infinity. And actually, in the theorem that I gave, I even tell you how this dependence on x naught is, right? It sort of enters into the less interesting error term. Okay, so it sort of really doesn't even depend which x naught is. It enters into this error term.
F is a function L2 or continuous?
F is continuous. Actually, it should be in the Sobolev space. So this norm should be finite. So this was prehistory. Now, the local limit theorem was open for a long time. And I think it was not, it was open and people were aware of it. I think it was fairly well-known open problem until I think two independent works in very recent. So one, which I think was posted first by Cohns and Gouvarche, gave in fact the local limit theorem exactly under the assumptions we have, if this rotation part has a spectral gap. And independently, Varju proved, in fact, a local central limit theorem. Now this, not just a local central limit theorem, but a quantitative local central limit theorem. It's basically the same statement like the statement we have. And the scale is not at all bad. It looks, it's still something which is way better than anything you'd get in the Euclidean case. The scale is a stretch exponential. It's not exponential, but it's exponential of a of a n to some power. Right, so that was, and this is completely general. Not the only assumption here is that the rotation part generated then subgroup of SOD. And okay, one ingredient of the proof is a why, how can Varju handle the general case? Well, he has a weak spectral gap, some kind of spectral gap, some kind of estimate of decay of functions with respect to the averaging operator that is not so simple. I mean, sort of, it will depend. The decay depends in also on how f oscillates, but some kind of weak spectral gap for the averaging operators, based on or related to various observations, which are so related, referred to the Solovey-Kitaev algorithm. Anyway. It's not what I'm talking about today, but this is, I was saying that our work is based on previous work of Varju. I'm referring to this paper. Now, in the passing, not related to what I'm going to talk about, because I'm just assuming that my rotation part have a spectral gap, let me just remind you of sort of maybe one of the most basic questions of the area. And so I told you that there was this result of Cohns and Gouvarche using the spectral gap assumption. There's another result by Varju, which did not just assume that the rotation parts span a dense group. Now, are these things different? I mean, is it true? It could possibly be true, and indeed, I personally believe it is true, and I'm not sure if it's formally conjectured by anyone, but I think Emmanuel believes it's true, right? That somehow, that whenever you have a random walk in SO3 or SU2, which are essentially the same group, whenever you have the support of the random walk generates a dense group, then the corresponding averaging operator will already have a spectral gap. And it's even not known what should be much, much, much easier, not for every two rotations, but for a typical rotation. It's actually, even that is not true, not known. But still, there is an important result which we can use to produce lots of examples of rotations with the spectral gap. And basically, Bourgain and Gamburd have proved that whenever you have a collection of rotations whose coefficients are algebraic numbers, so right, rotations are in particular 3x3 matrices, and I'm assuming that all the 9 entries are algebraic numbers, then once I have once these rotations generate a dense group, corresponding averaging operator has a spectral gap. Of course, the size of the spectral gap depends on the heights of the numbers, etc., etc., etc. But some spectral gap you would have. And I mean, in explicit cases, things which come from sort of theory of from representation theory, you could actually get a very explicit spectral bound. And sort of the simplest and nicest maybe is this example by Lubotsky-Philipsanek, where you have 6 rotations, rotation by a specific angle plus or minus around the x-axis, around y-axis, around the z-axis, some kind of slightly fancy Rubik's cube. This has a very good explicit spectral gap. Now, this is true for SO3, SU2. Bourgain and Gamburd generalized it to SUD. This is not a, this generalization is probably not for the faint of hearted, but anyway. It has been generalized. It requires some substantial additional work. And I believe that Benoit and Zaks have extended it probably to general simple compact Lie groups, but in any case to SOD. The statement that if you have, I hope it's okay, I'm presenting it, it's, anyway, it's a new result, fresh, that for us it's very nice because it allows us to generate very easily groups which satisfy our assumptions. Okay, the difference between, so the key to getting this better resolution is a new spectral gap result. And in fact, this new spectral gap result is of independent interest. And it has another application that I would show you in a few slides. So, this spectral gap result is slightly more technical, but it is in somehow the real theorem. So even though it is slightly technical and even though it is slightly analytic, and this is at least partially an audience of group theorists, I would want to present this spectral gap result. So I have some random walk on the isometry group. It acts on RD, so it acts on functions on RD. So it acts on L2 of RD, right? And if it acts on L2 of RD, if I have a function in L2, I know that the Fourier transform gives me an isometry between L2 of RD and, okay, L2 of RD. The Fourier transform is an isometry. And on Fourier space, the action is a bit different, right? On Fourier space, rotation in physical space becomes rotation in Fourier space, but translation in physical space becomes change of phase in Fourier space. So this is how these operators become. So I've changed notations here. Instead of using random variables notation, I take a measure and convolve it, but it's the same thing, right? So this is the averaging operator corresponding to this random walk, but on the Fourier side. This is the formula, this thing here. Now, what you see here is that this operator basically works shell by shell, right? So the Fourier, all of the Fourier coefficients of radius R. So what happens to them? They're going to be rotated, it's going to supply some phase, but I'm not going to each, so if you like the representation of the isometry group on L2 of RD, if I look at it, the Fourier transform, it decomposes into a direct integral of representations, being how this group acts on the L2, on the Fourier coefficients of size, of some given size. So this is this representation that I would call rho r, and if I look at the averaging operator for this representation, I would look at some operator sr. And I wrote explicitly how the representation works. So once I'm looking at L2 coefficients on some given radius, so basically I'm looking at functions in L2 of the sphere, and I have here an explicit representation, which is a twist of the representation by rotations. And with these notations, so this S0, if you put this parameter R equals 0, I get my averaging operator, which has a fixed vector, and except for this fixed vector, has a spectral gap. And now I have a family of operators. And what Varju and I proved is that, and you could quantify it, but it's a uniform spectral gap for this representation. So all of these operators, you can't really have a uniform spectral gap. I mean, so when R is bigger than zero, when I look at this representation, for R not equal to zero, there's no more any reason there to be a fixed vector. So somehow, when I mean here spectral gap, I mean that actually the norm of the operator is strictly less than one. And this is, of course, not true for R equal to zero. So I can't really have a uniform spectral gap for this family of operators because of this one eigenfunction, well, this constant eigenfunction for R equals zero. But I have this expression, which is uniform for spectral gap for R, let's say, bigger than one. Now, the spectral gap itself is not new. This was an ingredient in the work of Cohn's and Givarsh, but the uniformity is new. And uniformity, so a spectral gap is a nice thing to have. Uniform spectral gap is really even nicer. Uniform spectral gap is something which often is connected to very exciting things. So here's another application of the uniform spectral gap estimate. So now I have not isometries, but similarities, which are contracting, right? So I have rotation, contraction, translation. And I have some probability vector. And then there will be a unique probability measure, which is stationary under this action. So there will be, this is going to be self-similar. So some measure which you can get by choosing one of these contracting similarities randomly, applying it to the measure, averaging, you get back your measure. This is called self-similar measures. Quite popular, sort of, here's one of them, the Sierpinski gasket, which you get from taking three similarities. You take R2, you contract it by a factor of three, and then you move it up sort of along these directions which span an equilateral triangle. This is the Sierpinski gasket. And if the Sierpinski gasket is sort of a very nice picture, and the reason why there's a very nice picture is because it satisfies the open set condition that there's an open set, so that which is mapped into itself by each and every one of these similarities, but mapped into different disjoint sets. And this guarantees, so here you could take the triangle, the external triangle to the Sierpinski gasket, the interior of it, that's an open set which satisfies the open set condition. This implies that the self-similar set would be a nice set, the self-similar measure would be nice measure, sort of essentially equivalent to Hausdorff measure. Everything is very nice and good. But when the open set condition is not satisfied, then all hell breaks loose. It's sort of it's a mess. So even take the one-dimensional case, take two contractions, right? These two contractions, but the shift is different, same ratio of contraction. Take equally F1 and F2. Then the self-similar measures called Bernoulli convolutions. It's a well-known problem of Erdős, for which lambda between 1 and half and 1, when the open set condition is not satisfied, is this self-similar measure absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure? Or even what's sort of not known and would have, if you actually knew, you could get it with sufficient regularity of the Radon-Nikodym derivative, you would, in particular, prove the Lemmer's conjecture on Mahler measure, so it's sort of not a trivial statement, that it's not known that there would be some value strictly less than one, so for every lambda between this lambda bar and one, my Bernoulli convolution would be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. And so the same spectral gap estimate, which was the engine behind the improvement in the local central limit theorem, actually gives you something like that when you have, so it gives you exactly this, but when you have self-similar measures with rotations, and the rotations have a spectral gap. So if I have these a system of similarities, which depend on the parameter lambda, which is contraction ratio. Rotations part have a self-similar gap. Then under some mild assumptions, contractions don't have to be the same, sufficiently close to one, the self-similar measure is going to be continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure and even would have as many derivatives as you want. And so actually, if you want to use the different contraction ratios, then it's very convenient, or we need to use a beautiful lemma of Miklos Abelt. Okay, so there are more slides here, but the chairman is getting restless and I'm exceeding my time, so thank you.
Well, in that case,
there is a question.
Emmanuel.
Hmm? The application? The spectral gap?
This one.
This one? So, I mean, yeah, so somehow the statement is exactly what's it. So suppose maybe you take these six Lubotsky-Philipsonic rotations, then if you take take them and use them to make a self-similar measures by maybe contracting, then if the contraction is sufficiently small, as long as the translation part is not something too pathological, you'd always get a measure which is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure with 76 76 derivatives. And it's not so hard to see why it happens. So, well, it's not so hard if we don't need to use Miklos lemma, which is a beautiful statement. But if the contraction ratios are the same, then basically, if you look at the Fourier transform of the self-similar measure on some ball, it would be related to the, and you compare it to the Fourier transform of the self-similar measure on a ball of radius, so this is r and this is lambda r, then they are related by this twisted averaging operator. And if it has uniform contraction, then you have a uniform decay of the Fourier coefficients, and uniform decay of Fourier coefficients, if it's sufficiently strong, implies whatever you want. That's somehow how the connection works. So the connection, if the contraction ratios are the same, this is actually a direct application of the spectral gap result. If the ratios are not the same, then you need to call Miklos to help you.
So can you at least state this lemma by Miklos?
Where's Miklos? Is he somewhere? I can state the lemma, right? So, suppose I have, so A and B are two averaging operators on, these are averaging operators. Let's say by rotations on S of D. That's sort of the case I'm going to look at. Okay? And suppose I know that that for every V, that for every vector which is orthogonal to constants here, this is going to be less than Q over 2 the size of V. Okay? Then I can give you an explicit spectral gap estimate to A. Then A has then A has norm less than something. So you'd think maybe it's going to be caused. It's actually something which is roughly roughly square in Q.
So you see that there exists a Q, or for all Q?
No, no, this is the assumption, so for some Q, think of it as I have a spectral gap for this average, for this combined operator. And then this operator itself already has a spectral gap in a way which you could quantify.
Any further brief questions?
So your statement should be if I is lambda I, is a subscript I missing?
No, because there is I also in the superscript below. So f of lambda, and here you plug lambda equals lambda I.
Yes.
Okay. Well, now we have a coffee break until 11:15 when Thomas Dazan will speak. Let's thank Elon again.